the glories of this ancient race. Women as mothers are more directly sensible of the inequality and injustice of the present order and can bring about a deep and far-reaching change of spirit and work it into the new style of life. Then will the new man be born, unquote. It's a very beautiful quote from Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. So I thought today we are talking about the working woman, I should quote this. Madam, I must congratulate you for the topic you have chosen. You have expressed the pain of every working woman, how deeply our society is entrenched in patriarchal values. Being an academician, I would like to share with you that not only the society, but all the concepts we teach in the class have been conceptualized through the experiences of men, accommodating their needs, their aspirations, be it the concept of equality, liberty, or justice. It is only in the 20th century that feminist thinkers have challenged these notions. It is they who have transformed these concepts from a male-centric notion to a humanist notion. The way you have defined working woman, without claiming to be an academician, the great academicians have done the same thing. She has written in her paper that she is no more an academician. But all the feminist thinkers, what she has said in the paper has been said by all the feminist thinkers. Not only this, I am reminded of a great historian, Gerda Lerner, who says history has to be rewritten. We have forgotten the contributions of women. We have erased her from the pages of history. Therefore, we should write a contributory and compensatory history. She says now there is a need to write a contributory and compensatory history. Mahadevi Verma, a great Hindi poetess and literateur, wrote a revolutionary piece, Shrinkhla Ki Kadiyan. I am sure if Shrinkhla Ki Kadiyan would have been published in France, she would have been the first Simone de Beauvoir. Her writings are more radical than what Simone de Beauvoir has written. It's a radical piece of work which I think every one of us must read, where she attacked on these man-made false and biased images of women. This is the scenario worldwide. Women fighting for creating a space for themselves and for removing the status of being a permanent third world. I say women are a permanent third world, you know. One of the great philosophers wrote that we men have written their history on the back of women. So you will find that after years of struggle, still you find what is the situation in India. What is the situation of women in unorganized sector? You see, what is the situation of women who are having no land, about the landless women? Bina Agrawal has written a lot about that. And still we suffer from all those biases, and we have to go a very, very long way. And that is why I would not like to stand between Leila Seth and you, and that's why I would like that she should speak more. But madam, women like you are a role model for us. I would like to end by what Jawaharlal Nehru used to read, the lines of Robert Frost before going to bed. I love these lines. The woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I promise to keep, and miles to go before I sleep, and miles to go before I sleep. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam. May I now request Justice Leila Seth to kindly deliver 20th RKMN lecture. Madam.
Professor Chandrakala Padia, Chairperson, Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, Shimla. Professor Chetan Singh, Director of the Indian Institute of Advanced Studies. Mr. Prem Chand, friends, and ladies and gentlemen. The title, as you've heard, of my lecture is A Working Woman. I deem it a great privilege to have been asked to deliver the memorial lecture in honor of Dr. Sarvepali Radhakrishnan, a teacher and a philosopher president. I always admired him, apart from many other things, for the very generous gift of Rashtrapati Nivas, Shimla, for academic work. I believe he inaugurated the Indian Institute of Advanced Studies on 20th October, 1965, 50 years ago. I have a special link with that day, as it happens to be my birthday. And I was 35 years old, and I have visited the Institute on a number of occasions and enjoyed the beauty of the building, the special wood-lined area and library, and the wonderful location. I also attended some seminars and lectures and soaked in the academic atmosphere. Since I lived close by in Armsdale, the Chief Justice's house, I also had occasion to walk to the Institute and appreciate the vibrant red rhododendrons which covered the path. It was a beautiful sight. I'm not an academic, and I'm not used to writing lectures or learned texts, and feel inadequate in the company of great previous speakers, who are mostly professors. When Professor Chetan Singh suggested I deliver the 20th lecture in the Golden Jubilee year, I was apprehensive and told him so. But he persisted and I agreed. It is always difficult to decide on a subject to speak on. And though I toyed with the idea of speaking on the citizen and the constitution, I decided that a working woman was a more appropriate subject, as this century is being referred to as the women's century. But who is a working woman? She's been defined variously and succinctly as a woman who works for wages. Another definition is one who labors. This last would include all women, as they are all involved in housework and or looking after children and the family, which is known as domestic work. Strangely enough, when you are not paid for domestic work, you are not considered a working woman in common parlance. But if a maid or cook or nanny or housekeeper does domestic work and is paid, either in cash or in kind, she is thought of as a working woman. What if you do regular, unpaid, voluntary work outside the house? Are you a working woman? Today, most people would agree that you are. So it would appear it is not dependent on wages. So does it mean that going to work outside the house makes you a working woman? But today, many people work from the house on computers, and so do women writers, artists, etc. So it would appear that this is not also dependent on working inside the house. I think that basically it's a question of attitude. Often when you meet a woman for the first time and ask her what she does, she deprecatingly says, "I am just a housewife." So we now realize that in common parlance, a working woman is not a person who takes care of her home, children, family, etc., if she is not paid to do it. In olden days, men would go to hunt, and women stayed at home to cook and look after the children. And when they came back, tired and hungry, they were fed and looked after as well. Today, in rural societies, apart from the housework, women combine with men to work. So if the men do the plowing and the harvesting, women do the planting of seedlings. If men go out to fish, it is often the women that go out to sell the fish. But in an urban society, women were expected to stay at home and do the housework and take care of everyone, including the children and the elderly. This kept them subservient, so they were not economically independent. This suited the men, as women were treated as chattel with hardly any property or other rights. It was Gandhiji who said, and I quote, "Woman is the companion of man, gifted with equal mental capacities. She has the right to participate in the minutest details in the activities of man, and she has an equal right of freedom and liberty with him. She's entitled to a supreme place in her own sphere of activity as man is in his. This ought to be the natural condition of things, and not only as a result of learning to read and write. By sheer force of a vicious custom, even the most ignorant and worthless men have been enjoying a superiority over women which they do not deserve and ought not to have. Many of our movements stop halfway because of the condition of our women." The first few acceptable professions that women worked in were nursing, or teaching, or cooking, or looking after children. And they had to combine it with their own housework. The men did not help them with it. But all the major decisions were made by men, and they made it difficult for women to be educated and choose a profession they wanted. Women have had to fight for their right to work in some professions and be empowered. Women were also told that they were not capable or not meant to do these things. I'll talk about the legal profession and my own experience, as that is what I know best. It was so difficult for me to get into the profession, despite the fact that I had stood first in the whole of England in the bar examinations in 1957. When I came back to India, I had to join the chambers of a senior lawyer and apprentice with him for a year before I could practice on my own. Since I did not know anyone in the legal profession, I asked the registrar of the Calcutta High Court to give me the name of a competent senior barrister. He suggested Mr. Sachin Chaudhary, who later became the finance minister. I thought that I would telephone Mr. Chaudhary and seek an appointment, but it was impossible to get him on the phone. His calls were all filtered, and he obviously didn't speak to strange women. I realized that I had to find someone who would speak to him about me before I would get an appointment, but it was tedious and embarrassing to ask for a favor. Anyway, after a month of seemingly never ending, filled with bouts of despondency, I was granted an interview with the great legal luminary. I was full of fear and trepidation and want to prove myself to be I was full of fear and trepidation and I went to meet him, but put on a brave and smiling expression. Despite the fact that he knew why I had come, he wanted to be clear about the matter and asked me why, in his grace and gruff manner. After I told him, he said, "Instead of joining the legal profession, young woman, go and get married." I replied, "But sir, I'm already married." "Then go and have a child," he advised. I responded, "I have a child. It is not fair to the child to be alone. So young lady, you should have a second child." I replied, "Mr. Chaudhary, I already have two children." Taken aback for a third time, he said, "Then come and join my chambers. You are a persistent young woman and will do well at the bar."